Prince Rupert drop is a fascinating study of the properties of glass. I'm forming a Prince Rupert drop now by heating a piece of glass rod. This is regular soft glass, like you would use for making stirring rods, as opposed to Pyrex. I'm heating it with a propane torch, and if you will note, I'm heating the bottom of the drop. And that's important, I found, in the technique. Keep the bottom of the drop of glass, of this molten glass as it's forming, in the tip of the burner flame. The tendency is to heat the neck, where the glass drop is trying to form, but you will find better success if you heat the bottom of the drop. We've got this over a beaker of tap water, and as soon as the drop separates and it falls into the water, it's going to make a terrible sound. If you were going a several thousand degree temperature change, you would make a terrible sound too. There it goes. And sometimes when the drop forms, it shatters on impact because of the huge thermal change that's taking place. And other times, the drop survives. Let's see if we can fish that drop out real quickly. And that one was successful, and it survived. And what I have is a tiny little glass, little teardrop, and it's got a long thread on it. We can carefully break off a little piece of that thread, and it leaves us with what's called a Prince Rupert drop. And if we can go to the overhead camera, we can see several of those that are preformed here. And those are Prince Rupert drops. Prince Rupert of Bavaria in the mid-1600s probably did not invent Prince Rupert drops, but they were named for him because of the work that he did in popularizing and spreading these. Prince Rupert drops are stressed glass, and they have an amazing property. They are actually stronger than steel, and that's not something that we would anticipate from that. These little drops were heated to a very, very, very high temperature. They dropped into the water. The outside of the drop cools instantly and locks that shape of that teardrop in place. Then, of course, glass having a rather high heat capacity, the glass on the inside cools much more slowly. And as it cools and contracts, it places extreme internal compressive forces onto that drop. What happens then is that we've got all of these forces pulling inward, and it makes that drop extremely strong. Unless the surface is scratched or the tip of the tail is broken, which shatters that almost surface tension-like property, kind of like you would expect with water, shatters that and the internal forces are released. And that's what we're going to demonstrate with this process now. So what we're going to do is to place some of these Prince Rupert drops in a glass bag. On the mark there so you can see that. And what we'll do is we're going to take and hold that drop, and I'm going to hammer onto this. And so we're hammering on that little glass drop, but not on the tail. And as we hammer on that, I've had students who are testosterone charged who have actually dented my lab tables with the force of trying to break those glass drops. They couldn't. And since then, I've learned to use a ring stand or something as a protective force underneath that to save my expensive epoxy glass tabletops. But what happens then is that if we just break off the tip of that tail, then what will happen is that glass will instantly shatter as all of those compressive forces are released inside of there. So let's see if we can manage to make that happen. Did you catch that? Shall I do it one more time? So here we have our glass drop. And I'm just going to take and grab a hold of that and see if I can move my fat fingers out of the way. So that you can get a view of that on the camera. And then what I'm going to do is just snap. There it went. and it instantly shatters. So you can hammer and pound on that forever, but when you snap off the little tail, all you end up with is glass dust. Now you notice that I've done this inside of a bag, that way we contain the glass pieces that are in there. Sometimes, if the tail on the Prince Rupert drop is very short, it will be difficult to break, and there are people who are obviously fearful of taking and getting that little sharp piece of glass and cutting their finger with it, and rightly so. So what you can also do is you can have your Prince Rupert drop inside of the bag, and then you can use a pair of pliers to bend off that tail. That way you wouldn't injure your finger or poke it. What you also have to be mindful, though, is that when you're holding that drop, the force of all of that energy inside releasing, it stings your fingers just a little bit. It's not terribly painful, but it's a surprise. So when the first time you do that, that would be a little bit of a problem for you. The Prince Rupert drops are a fun little activity, and I use them for a variety of different purposes. One of the main ways that I use this is we have an open house night where we do science experiments all one evening late in the spring as an attention process to help recruit students for science the next year, and in a sense just to kind of get kids excited into science. And oftentimes I'll have some of my students who are making the Prince Rupert drops and then demonstrating them to their peers and to their parents and brothers and sisters that might be in, just to tell them a little bit about that process. We've all worked with glass before, and that's something very unusual. These are very expensive to buy, but they're very easy to make with just the regular glass here. The other way that I use this is when I'm teaching, and we're talking about the states of matter, solids, liquids, and gases. And we talk about that we've got regular crystalline solids, such as the sodium chloride crystals and things of that type. But then we also talk about that there are materials which are amorphous solids. And we talk about butter or plastics or things of that type. Well, glass is another type of an amorphous material. And that amorphous solid material has different properties and characteristics. This is, in a sense, somewhat similar to tempered glass. The windshield of your car, the shower door of your bath shower or your storm windows, those types of glass are often made with safety glass. And that safety glass is formed, then it's heated back up, and then it's cooled at a regulated process. That way, when it breaks, it doesn't break into the shards that we're familiar with from our window panes, but it tends to crumble, more like what the crumbling that we have in the little glass pieces in here. Now let's go back and talk again about what we had. I used a propane torch to make this happen. It is not possible to use a Bunsen burner, a Meeker burner, a Fisher burner, any type of regular natural gas type burner that you have to melt the glass. It just doesn't get hot enough. You need to use a propane torch. The propane torches are not expensive. I know that sometimes people are fearful of them. They look very, very dangerous. They're really not any more dangerous or any more difficult to use than a typical Bunsen burner would be. Notice that while I was heating the glass, I was slowly turning the glass rod so that that glass rod would heat evenly. And again, as I mentioned at the beginning, the key I found to getting these glass drops to be successful is that you need to be sure that you are heating the bottom of the drop where the largest mass of glass is. Keep that part hot. Let the drop fall on its own. Don't get greedy and try to create a glass drop the size of your thumb. If you have a large enough heat source, you can make that happen. Pyrex will also work. But with Pyrex, you're going to have yet a hotter flame source. So using a propane torch, which is readily available from your hardware or discount stores, and using the regular soft or the flint glass, the soda glass, works very well, the same type of thing that you would use for making stirring rods or working with those types of materials. It's a really, really fascinating process. The students are enthralled with the Prince Rupert drop and how that it has so much strength when you beat on it, and yet merely snapping or scoring that tail instantly shatters it, and that is an amazing process. Just a moment ago, we saw the Prince Rupert drop and how we formed that, and we talked a little bit about the huge internal stresses that were present in that glass drop. Now we will be able to visualize those internal stresses. We've got a light box with two pieces of polarizing film, and between them we have our Rupert's drop sandwiched in between. If we take and rotate one of these top layers, what we will see inside is the rainbow, the variations of colors. Glass blowers and makers often use polarizing film to demonstrate the internal stresses that are found in glass when they need to eliminate them. And by using the polarizing film like this, you should be able to see iridescent colors in the glass drop. Those are an indication, a visual indication, of the extreme pressures and forces that are acting inside that drop. So this is just another way to see that rather than just talking about it. You can see that. If you take polystyrene, such as a plastic petri dish or something, and you also place that between polarizing film, you will see similar types of stresses in the plastics. But with this Rupert drop, we see the internal stresses in there. So that's Rupert's drops. Thank you very much.